for? Always like to see who I'm preaching to. Actually, I'm not preaching to anybody. I'm sharing the gospel as the Spirit leads me. Not the sermon that I want, but the sermon that you want. The sermon that you need for your life at this moment. Not some glorious theology. And there are multiple. There's infinite theologies. Meaning, how it is that I understand God's presence in the world and what God has done in the world. And we could sit here till 9 o'clock tonight and we would discuss amongst each other what it is that we believe about everything. The reality, my friends, is we know very little except that the Spirit reveals it to us. Honestly, it's because we're just not smart enough. We think that we are. You remember the story about, I'm looking at mustard seeds myself right now in my own life. I know that faith exists, and I know that I need it. I also know that I need it, but I cannot earn it, nor do I deserve it. What I do know is that God chooses to give that to me in spite of myself. We not, as some do, seem to be begging God to love us. Begging God to be present amongst us. Or spending our life trying to find God and coming up empty. We do not have to work hard to find God because God has already found us. It's not how much one understands about Scripture and theology that makes God evident. It only has to do with the movements of the Spirit within us that we know, in fact, that God does exist. The power that we need for that is a gift that God gives us. I don't have to go and punch a time clock and begin to work for God to give me something at the end of the day. The wages have already been paid. The bills no longer exist. Because of Jesus, not because of the church, not because of theology, not by being right with God, has God freed me to be the person that God has called me to be from the beginning of all time. Before I was even in the womb, God knew me. Boy, did he know that? Did he know what a handful he had? I guess we would all say that, wouldn't we? For we are all just children. We think that we have matured because we have age on us. Some of the most mature people I know are young. And some with believing that they have the most wisdom. Has nothing to do with age. That's just chronology. We've survived another day. Isn't that what life is? That's what age is. I woke up this morning and I was still alive. Hallelujah. Another day has passed. Another day is beginning. It is my decision how to live that gift that God has given me today. I can live it in faith and trusting that God will be with me in all things, or I can say, I'll call you when I need you. Seems like in the culture today, many times we don't even think about God until our life falls apart. And then we will say funny things like, where was God in all of this? The Spirit must giggle. I have been with you in all of it. I've connected with him in all of it before you even knew that it was coming. I know that you need what I have to offer, and it's a free gift, but you will have to accept it and trust that the gifts that I give are better than anything that you can conjure up. Money won't do it. Some of the saddest folks I know on this planet are very wealthy, because their whole life is based upon their false understanding that they can buy anything. The poorest man is the wealthiest of all, because he or she knows that that which is the most valuable, God gives to him or her freely. If he or she wants. Story about a family, and there were 6 children in the family. That would make me nuts. So early on Sunday morning, the children have been bathed the night before, so the older children are attempting to help the younger children get dressed. You know how that is. Everything is chaotic. We have to be at church before 9:30. We don't want to be late. They're sitting around this table, and everyone has had something except the little one sitting in the chair. The one that has been catered to all of his or her life. And on this morning, it seems that everybody has forgotten this child. And the mother looks over and says, "Oh, my Lord, I've forgotten to feed the baby." She takes a piece of bread and puts it in the toaster. Bam. Everybody else is pulling on the mother, maybe the father, to have all of their needs met. And this one child who's always had his or her needs met, all of a sudden, the toaster pops up. The mother takes the bread out of the toaster and lays it on the child's plate. This child has never spoken a word before, because his or her needs have always been met. It's almost as though the family knew what she needed and anticipated that. This morning, things are different. You can hear the toast hitting the plate right now, can't you? Honk. The child picks up the piece of toast and says to the family, the child has never spoken one word. This child is about 3 years old. And the child says, "My damn toast is burnt." What did he or she say? The family's astonished. They're overwhelmed. This child who never spoke before, because all of his or her needs had been met before they had even anticipated it. All of a sudden, this life of perfection, this life of having all power and having all needs anticipated, somehow did not work out. This morning was different. The chaos of life did not make the child sitting in the high chair the center of the universe. Life happens. Sometimes your toast is done perfectly, and sometimes your English muffin is burnt. That's just the way it is. That's just the way it is for us. We holler and scream when our toast is burnt. We complain about the smallest things and forget about the most important things. Faith is something that God gives us as a gift. You cannot earn it. It is free. It cannot be taken away from you, but it can remain small as a mustard seed. Now, I've had some mustard seeds. Has everyone here had a mustard seed in their hand before? Who hasn't seen a mustard seed? Well, good. I don't have to pass any of them out. Thanks. Thank you, Jude. Hmm. Mustard seeds in the Middle East are considered weeds. And they're sowed everywhere, and it's just like having crabgrass in your yard. You don't know it's there until it comes forth as maturity. No one wants crabgrass in your yard, so they spend all sorts of money trying to get rid of it. It's the same way with faith. The world is trying to rob you of that faith. The world is going to throw burnt toast in front of you. And everything that you used to think that you understood is now totally changed. And then one begins to say, do I believe in anything anymore? Let me get in my prayer closet, if one has it, or your prayer man's cave, and sit down and seriously before God, you and God, you and the Spirit, ask the question, where is my faith? What does it look like? When will I know that I have it? And the answer is, you will never know when you have it. You will only know when you don't. Having faith is a gift that is given to you at your water baptism. You do not need multiples because you're not in charge of it. This baptism wasn't good enough. Guess I'll have to be baptized again. Reality is baptism is a sacrament. Who can recite what a sacrament is from the catechism? Thank you so much. Must have grew up in my diocese. Sideline. Jesson Child, who's a bishop of Atlanta, a dear friend of mine, my family, said that he expected one thing from Christians when they're confirmed, is that the fruit of the Spirit show in their lives immediately. What does your priest expect of you? The same. And you expect that of him or her. That being the case, the development of faith requires an entire community. What do you want when you're feeling lonely and hopeless? You want the Spirit, but you also want like-minded spiritual people around you. Otherwise, why would he even go to church? If we don't come here for community and an opportunity to say, my life really stinks right now, and I have no idea what to do, I don't know who to ask for support, I'm afraid to ask because I'm supposed to handle everything in the 21st century. I don't need anybody in the 21st century. And the reality is, you have always needed something more than what you could grasp or what you could manufacture. That's been from the time of the first birth. The ones that happened this very afternoon, this morning. We cannot live a life of faithfulness unless we live in a community of faithfulness. Well, some people say, hey, now I have faith and I can listen to Joel Osteen on Sunday mornings on TV and I get all the religion that I need for the week. God help you. That's 21st century religion. Religion means a set of beliefs that defines your life. What is your religion? I am a Christian. That is what my religion is. How does it affect me? It makes me greater than I could ever be by myself. Why? Because the Spirit who created me loves me so much as He wants all of that which He has given me to show fruit in the world. You mean just in private amongst your family? No. If you believe that, your family's too small. We need each other. Well, where's all this mustard seed plant in the field? All that kind of stuff have to do with anything. The Spirit plants the seeds of faith everywhere. Sometimes it will look like crabgrass and you will try to destroy it as soon as possible. For your first task of the day is to go to Lowe's or Home Depot. To acquire a substance that may take this away from me because I'm seeing it but it's not what I thought it was going to be. So therefore, I must discard it as soon as possible because I don't want to seem, number one, too religious. Faith in our personal belief is important because it is not temporal like our jobs that we have. How many of you know that you'll have more than one job in your life? Sometimes that second or third job comes unexpectedly, doesn't it? So can I depend on the world to supply my needs? The answer is what? Can you expect a corporation to be loyal to you from the time you take your first paycheck till you get your gold watch? No. And guess what? It never did. We in our culture are having to change because the status quo has shown up to be empty, powerless. And even the church that we have attended all of our life, we start asking the question, has it made any difference in my life because I've been here? Have I made any difference in anyone else's life because of my belief and trust in Jesus? I believe. Like our former bishop, Michael Curry, loved dearly, used to do most of his preaching at Starbucks. Share faith in the midst of the public? How? How absurd. That has become the mindset of the church, especially for our tradition, is we are afraid that if we mention our faith out in the world, we will be ridiculed, laughed at, because we believe in something that we cannot see. They believe in something that they see that will not last. Can I share a personal secret? Long time ago, I'm aware that I had an opportunity to buy gold at $32 an ounce. And I had $3,200 in cash. And I was considering buying 100 ounces of gold. That's when you could own it at the very beginning. And those who were in my life said, that is ridiculous. We need a new washing machine, a washer, and a dryer, all this kind of stuff. And we need new tires on the car, et cetera. Before you knew it, that $3,200 was gone. And where is it today? In some landfill. We can take everything that we believe and invest it like that in something that will only be temporal and only last for a while. We can say that about our lives. Our lives are perfect and we are excited about our lives and we think it's always going to be like it is in this moment. Stand by. Listen to the quarterback. One MC. It's going to change. Everything changes from moment to moment. Nothing is like it used to be. Nothing will be as it once was. Every moment in our life is changing, and we must change with it, or we will surely die. I wonder why those stories about zombies have become so important. To me, it's a transference of what the culture thinks about itself. It's walking around but has no life. It's walking around and pretending that it's got it all under control. But on that which gives life, which is internal within their spirit and the spirit of God within them, has gone dry and old and has been discarded, and they cannot find that which will replace that they think that they have lost. gathered around the table, and every single person around that table is looking at some electronic device. That speaks something about our culture. It's very important that we look at this and we don't ignore it. Because what it says in the culture is that the family has forgotten how to be with each other. It's easier to be with a flat screen than it is to be with your mom or dad or your brothers or sisters or your cousins or your aunts or your grandparents. Because I stare at the screen because I have nothing left to share with anyone. What I do, I will share in secret. That's called Facebook. Instagram. Twitter. Hate Twitter. We won't go there. All this to say is, do you see how the world has influenced your thinking? How the world has taken life out of your own families? Because we have bought into what the culture says, that anything that means anything is on a flat screen. Everything else is useless. I used to say, my parents don't know anything about me. They have no idea what I'm going through. And I would try to find ways to avoid them because I didn't want to hear the truth that they had by their experience, because I thought my parents were naive and didn't know anything. Well, they actually don't. And we have to teach them. What we need to teach them is to share with them what we're missing in our life. It requires us to have a flat screen in front of us all the time, because there's no faith even the size of a mustard seed. So therefore, I must rely on everything that the world has to offer, because other than that, there's nothing. I could go on, and you know, I'm capable of it. But I won't. Looking at my little box of container of mustard seeds yesterday, I wonder how many seeds have been thrown at me and I've busted them away. How many opportunities that I've had in my life to hear what God is saying to me about me and saying to me about His love for me, and I've just brushed it aside. It's just a small weed in my way. I don't know about you. But I'm going to have to grow up. And to realize the reason that I was created is to love God, be loved by Him. And until I see our Lord face to face, I have a big responsibility in sharing that with people that I love. Don't expect your priest or your deacon to spend every moment of his or her life trying to convince you that there is a God. Your priest and your deacon are instruments of the Spirit to coach you, not to forgive you, not to make you feel good on the inside, but to proclaim a message to the world that the power that we really seek is already here, but we can ignore it and we can depend upon the world and think that the world's going to give us everything that we need. And the reality is, the only one who's going to give you everything that you need is God's Spirit, God's love for you. Without that, you are hopeless. Most people who have not lived under threat and oppression will never get this. Coptic Christians in Iran and Iraq get it. Will we ever get it? I hope and pray that we do. But once we get a slight glimpse of understanding it, the first thing that we must do is call our best friend on the phone and say, come here, I've got something to share with you. We are not alone. We don't have to worry about sickness and dis-ease. Because the peace that passes all understanding has revealed Himself to my heart, and I now have hope. Not through my own being, scriptures tell us we have been adopted by Christ. So that when Jesus sees us face to face, he will call us by name. I don't know the majority of your names, but God knows every one of your names. God knows about everything in your life that you need, and probably the things that you want. But pray that God gives you what you need in this world, in this life today. So you may walk out of these doors knowing what true peace is. That is the peace that passes all understanding. God bless you. God bless your journey. And I pray that you will pray for me that my journey will be made complete. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, of his greatness, mercy, and love, we give.